Okay, now I'm recording and we're rolling. Okay, either the cloud or my PC, I'll figure it out later. So good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everyone. Thanks for joining, folks. This is the Large Scale Scrum Meetup of New York City, the largest and hopefully the fastest growing meetup in the world. For us, this is a bit of bragging about ourselves. Yes, indeed. We have a great guest speaker today, a colleague of mine. Also, at one point, he was my mentor on a certain part of my Less Trainer journey, Jurgen de Smet. He's out of Belgium. Jurgen is a very well-respected and well-experienced organizational design consultant, trainer, and coach. He has been practicing less for a number of years. He is based out of Europe, if I'm not mistaken, but he travels the world as needed. At least up until recently, he has. He has a lot of tricks up his sleeve to share. And this is really without too much analogy here, right? But he is really versatile in the way he presents information, in the way he teaches. He's got tricks and tips and virtual tools that he uses that really strike, you know, bring it home and you know, make content very relevant. And of course, in the context of large-scale Scrum, he's got many years of Less adoptions, and he knows Craig and Craig Larman Basvody personally well as well. So in any case, without any further ado, he will be sharing with us today some of his experiences with large-scale Scrum adoption, specifically touching upon the business agility aspect of it. And he has a very interesting, unique way to engage us today by using Kahoot. He's going to tell more about it, but this is going to materialize as the some sort of a prize. He's going to let you know in a second. So if you have a phone handy, just like I do, please log in using kahoot.it or the app. I'm going to pass it on to you. So the floor is yours. Take it away.
Okay, cool. We have 47 participants, 24 players. So I expect more players to join. You can do split screen or whatever. So there is a decent price to win. Now we can always adjust the price according to your needs afterwards as well. As long as we are in similar ranges, that's all okay. Now let's get it going. So I hope Kahoot is going to help me out sufficiently, because for me, that's also an experiment. It's my first presentation using Kahoot. Now, there we go. So when Jean was like, okay, the business agility aspect of Less, I was thinking about outcome-based backlogs, which I intend to use in my gigs, or when I mentor organizations going to Less. And this is pretty much giving you insights in, I would say, three experiments I ran. So one experiment started at Base Company, which is my case study being published on, one of the case studies being published at Less.Works. A telco, one of the biggest telco operators in Belgium. And then it progressed into two more recent customers that are actually using it on whiteboards on a wall. So I want to give you this kind of insights in outcome-based battles, while giving you the opportunity to win a prize and to engage with me and all the others in the room. Now that's about it. If I look at myself, I started with Scrum in 1998, by the way. So, and the scaling part came around 2006, and I'm one of the few lucky ones that never really went to the dark side. By luck, by accident, by insights, I immediately came to Less-alike structures. Now, been a trainer since 2015, I guess. I'm one of the first, and that's more than enough about me. The rest you can find online. So, the prize you can win. So for the person that asked, like, can I have a 50-minute training session with or introduction to my product owner about outcome-based backlogs, maybe you can, you know? The person that actually wins the Kahoot at the end of the talk will get this gift voucher for a 2-hour free of mentoring call with myself. So we can have a 2-hour video call with yourself or with your whole team or with your manager, I don't care. So as long as I understand the topic up front that I can prepare, that's good enough. And you get a 50% discount on any of my courses being organized by Co-Learning. So some of my courses are organized by partners. That's something I cannot judge by myself, so I cannot give you that voucher. But everything that's organized by Co-Learning, I can. So this is your price. I might add stuff along the way, or depending on what is happening. So, but that's the minimum. Clear? So if you want to win this kind of prize, please join the Kahoot. It's still open, I guess. So the game pin is below at the bottom of the screen. So please join. So here we go. The first poll question. If we talk about outcome-based backlist, or you using outcome-based backlist? Almost everybody answered. A few more to go. And time's up. So there's a quite a spread. So some are deftly using it. So there are quite some people that think, yes, very sure about it. Definitely not. So it's quite a spread. So there might be some misunderstandings about what is meant by outcome-based or not. So this kind of spread, 6, 6, 7, 6. We're going to evaluate by the end if we went through outcome-based backlist, at least my perception. It's just my perception and an experiment I ran with customers. If you have a different one, that's okay. But according to my perception, let's evaluate at the end where we at. So thanks for giving me this insight. Some will learn about it. Some will maybe perfect their vision about outcome-based backlist, and that's cool. No need to answer this one. So prerequisites to really run outcome-based backlist. I never had this in my initial talks about outcome-based backlist or sharing the experiment, but I felt that I need to put it in there to make sure that people have the right context in their head to be able to run this kind of an experiment effectively. And I think this is the most important part. It's related to product definition. It's related to the level of transparency you achieve, at least within a review session at the end of the sprint, or the level of integration, depending on how you want to put it. And then your organizational structure, of course. So let's go into product definition. And I want to see what your insights are into product definition. I will use a couple of the companies or gigs I helped with in adopting more business agility related practices. So the first one is a base company, and I'll ask you a question here as well. It's a multi-select, so multiple options are possible. What would be the product of base company, which is a telecom operator? Is it customer self-servicing? Is it the phone plus a mobile subscription? Is it mobile connectivity, or is it a physical network? Or is it all of them together? It's a very short time frame, yeah? So you need to be fast in answering. Or maybe you have a slow network connection. Could also be. For base company, we ended up with mobile connectivity as the product. This was not the initial product when we started with less adoption. It was a lot smaller. So, and if we talk to people like in sales, or people that are in the shops selling phones and subscriptions, then it would be the phone plus a mobile subscription, something they sell to end users in that sense. Then again, as an end user, I could think and I could say, you know what, for me, product is also the customer self-servicing website. So the things I can arrange my complete subscription model with, that's for me the product. People that are putting down the 5G networks, for example, and all things could think about the physical network that actually provides the connectivity. Is it? At the end, we grew the product towards mobile connectivity. So you cannot really touch it, but it's all the other components in one. So the customer self-servicing is part of product. The phone and mobile subscription is part of product. The physical network is part of product. This creates a huge transparency in your backlogs, of course. So, and that's about base company. So this is a telco operator. Maybe you're not that familiar with the telco operator. So let's go with another example with an insurance company. So at this moment in time, let's see. My friend in Poland, you're apparently in the lead at this moment in time on producting. So, cool. For the insurance company, again, a multi-select. So Centraal over here is a Dutch company that is actually an insurance company. What would be their product? Is it partner in living? Is it insurances, covering all kinds of insurances? Is it solar panels? Is it a car insurance or travel insurance, or are all different products? Two seconds, last seconds, and boom. So most people were going into insurances covering all. And I think that would be most probably the logical thinking about it. For Centraal Beheer, which is this Dutch company, they moved it beyond it. They went to, we are a partner in living. So that's a great thinking. So they're not there only for insurances. We are a partner in living. We make your life easier in that sense. We make sure you don't need to worry about those things. And that's a great thing. Why? They could elaborate. So if you look at this, okay, new in between thing, so we'll see at the end. But if you look at Centraal Beheer and they say, okay, partner in living, they came with solar panels. Sorry for the Dutch here, but anyhow, they don't have an English website, so I cannot put in English screenshots. So, but zonnepanelen, as it's being put there, is solar panels. You also see in the picture, I'm not joking. So it's an insurance company that will arrange for you to have solar panels. So if you subscribe, they actually do an online scan of your roof, and then they make sure you get a nice offer. And the benefit they have as an insurance company, because of claims they get, they know who not to contact as a supplier of solar panels. So they can get you into touch with really qualitative suppliers of solar panels and people that put it on your roof. So that's what they did. So this is an easy way to make sure you get into this. They even went beyond it. So something I really find nuts for an insurance company. So if you look at, they do klushulp. Klushulp in Dutch means we are there as, we are here to do any kind of chore you have. So any kind of chore, I need some gardening to do or weeding to do, or I need some groceries. So they arrange this for you. So they have this kind of platform where within 24 hours you can say, okay, this is the kind of job I want to be done. And they make sure it happens for you within the 24 hours. And this is not only for their customers, they do it for everybody. Also there, because of claims, they understand where to have the right people, not the right people. And it provides them, if they think now about product, a partner in living, it provides them a reasonable and very interesting discussion on what is the best value to bring next. How can we actually increase the ease of living for our customers, but even non-customers? And as such, maybe even upsell from this kind of chore support service towards insurances and the other way around, if it turns out bad. So how can we support the people in that more? So you see as well, by broadening your product, you get more of an interest from a business side. If my product would be, I don't know, a platform that is arranging the billing for my mobile subscription, yeah, you know, I'm talking about, let's add feature blah blah to the SAP system that is facilitating the invoicing for the end customer. It's not that interesting as a business customer to discuss about that as a business person. If we now start talking about business like this chore thing, how do we connect it to our insurances? That's a lot more interesting, of course. So having a broad sense of product, a whole product focus in that sense, which are very much customer centric, is for me some kind of prerequisite to go to a real outcome based back. So that's number one. Clear enough? Yeah, okay. At least some people are giving me signals. Great, thank you. So that's one. The next thing that was what I was talking about is a high level of transparency or a high level of integration. If you look at the principle behind Scrum, it would be empirical process control. So I'm pretty sure you're all familiar with that. Inspect that based on a high level of transparency. At least on product level, at least within the review sessions, of course. So if we say transparency, we could think like, okay, you know what, our Gantt chart is also providing transparency. Of course, if I ask you, is it a high level of transparency or a low level of transparency, then most probably you will also agree that's a low level of transparency. There's so much in between translation that it's like, if I ask you how far are we now with building a software product in that sense, giving a Gantt chart is not giving us a high level of transparency. It gives us some transparency, and then we would inspect and adapt on some of the illusions, some of the opaque ideas that are there and not the true reality. That's why in Agile, we have transparency at the end of a review session. It should be at least working software. One of the principles behind Agile. So working software at least. So let's get you to work again. So take your things out. What level of transparency do you want in review sessions? And then order from highest level of transparency towards lowest level of transparency. Go for it. Some people had different IDs, at least. If I go from low to high, so from right to left instead of left to right, I know it's a bit uncommon as a European people to go, or a Western people to go right-left, but anyhow, let's do it. So for the four options that was presented, like a microservice working on my machine and mocking everything surrounding that microservice, it's an okay level of transparency, and it's higher than a Gantt chart, by the way, but it's still pretty low in that sense. So it can be a starting point, but then we need to figure out how can we get to a higher level of transparency in our review session so that we can inspect and adapt on more of the reality. So having a product somewhere in OTA, so the development environment, testing environment, acceptance environment, one of those things, mocking some of the external systems maybe, but having the higher level of integration would give you more of a higher level of transparency to inspect and adapt on your product. And also to have more sensible, valuable discussions with business people when we talk about what is the next best thing to do. Of course, a product in production environment is even better. So if you can really put it in production environment, we discuss about that, that's even a higher level than having it in a development test or acceptance environment. But you can go beyond. Lots of people think that's where it stops, but you can go beyond. One of the customers I work with, and in Austin, Texas, by the way, so Sparefoot, which is the storage, it's like the Airbnb for storage houses. They really went beyond. And some of the startups I'm working with, they also do this. They don't talk about the software and the feature. They talk about the user statistics and actually market trends. So they already put features into production multiple times a day. And in the review session, they collect the statistics and the market trend data to evaluate what's the next best thing to do, which is, again, a hell of a lot more interesting than talking about some kind of small feature on a billing platform. So also there, if you talk about integration is like the first. We need a highly integrated product, but you can even go beyond and see, okay, well, can bring us even a higher level of transparency so that we inspect and adapt even more of the reality in that sense. So that's an important aspect to remember. So you don't need to have user statistics, you need to grow this. If you look at those things now, you need to grow beyond that. So the thing is that most of the people are definitely in a large scale. They have component teams or small components that they work with, or not the real product and not the fully integrated. And getting fully integrated becomes very troublesome, mostly because of technical practices, by the way. But anyhow, it is what it is. What do people have there? They have the definition of almost done. That's something we don't want. So something you really need to engage with to go into outcome-based battles is to grow this definition of done and to remove the undone within your organization. It could take decades, by the way. So some organizations that go pretty fast, depending on the complexity of the product, of course, the technology stack, hardware involved or not involved. So, but it could take decades to actually grow this cone here to the right side so that you maybe even have marketing and production. So, and I love to have marketing people inside the less environment or the development environment, because then we can start applying growth hacking techniques and things like that. And then we even discuss more of that thing on acquiring new customers or activating new customers. And not only like, do they use this feature? So growing this kind of thing is definitely in scope. If it's too narrow, then forget about engaging in valuable discussion with business people or business-oriented people. You need to have some level. At some level, you will have valuable discussion, and then you can even grow beyond. So that's another prerequisite. We need to be able to press the button, as we want to call it. So structure-wise, how many teams do you have working on a single product backlog? Let's see what you have. Boom. So at least the majority, so 12 of the players that answered in time, have 4+ teams working on a single product backlog. If you have, or in the green scenario where the 7 people there, where they say, okay, I have one team, one backlog, that's going to be a bit more difficult to make sure that we move forward. The reason because of that, you will see in the next slide, by the way. So the reason is very simple. If we say we have 8 teams, which is like the maximum according to the lesser rules, but don't stick to it. Wysoft. So Wysoft is in the printing industry in Czech. And it's one of a customer we support in their LES adoption. They start in 2018. Today, really today, they have 13 teams. So 13 teams working on one product backlog. And now they start to feel the pain. Now they start to discuss how can we create areas. So you don't split or add more structures or divide more until it hurts too much. And that's a good practice because then you keep still having valuable discussions on a business level if you discuss in a review session. If you have 8 teams, for example, and there's 7 people in each team, so this would mean that we have 56 people available to work on that backlog. If you have 56 people in a 2-week sprint, that's 10 days. So this would mean that we spend 560 man days in a single 2-week sprint. It means as well that we can do a significantly impactful business delivery in a single sprint. If it's a single team, 7 people, 10 days, that's 70 man days. Maybe we can do something, but it's not going to be significantly impactful towards the business. With 560 man days, you should be able at least to deliver something significantly impactful towards the business, which is worth discussing. I think that's also a very important aspect in this scenario. So the prerequisites, have a whole product focus, really as broad as you can. If it's too narrow, valuable discussions will not happen. At a certain moment in time, it starts growing, and then you can even grow as far as possible, as long as it doesn't hurt too much. And level of transparency or the level of integration as well, at a certain moment in time, it will be good enough to work with outcome-based backlogs, and then you can grow beyond, as Parfood did. So, and then the organizational structure is important. If it's one team, one backlog, then most probably it's not going to fly by having sensible business discussion or really work with outcome-based backlogs. Then you first need to figure out on how to move multiple teams under one backlog before thinking about trying this experiment, which I will guide you to. So product definition, don't think iOS, don't think Android or any other platform or component. You need to suck it up into a bigger hole. So we don't want this kind of loosely coupled equipment over there, which it's like the IKEA model of software engineering. This might work in a business model for IKEA, where we leave the assembly to the end user. But if we deliver a software product, then the assembly should be happening. So we want at least a usable product where we can think, okay, what's the next improvement or best next improvement to do? And that's where it's getting useful for business. And of course, if we need to move mountains, and we do it just with one team, then it's going to be small pieces. And then you have this kind of idea that we need to go with a minimal viable product maybe, or a minimal testable product, which I like better, and then we don't deliver the full impact. So we really want to deliver business impact, and most probably you will need a higher the availability of a higher level of capacity available to deliver this thing. So that's an important aspect. And then you can start uncovering batteries. We always think this product backlog is a flat list. I think the reason because people think it's a flat list is because of tooling like Jira and Target Process and all the rest of the misery. It doesn't need to be. So if you understand the product backlog is there to provide some transparency again, which we can inspect on that, some transparency on a possible future, then we can try to experiment with different alternatives of a flat list, enabling business discovery and delivery more often. So and that's what I did with a couple of customers, mixing up different ways of working into an alternative method. It starts with a week. So a week is a widely important goal. So what is a widely important goal? Most probably in your organization, you have many, many metrics in place and many goals that you want to achieve, and some are related to keeping your business up and running. And a widely important goal means if we don't put extra attention on this goal, then it won't change whatsoever. So in a widely important goal, you will most probably have many of those as well. You need to be able to order them. So I will not say prioritize because priority is one factor of ordering, there's many other stuff. And if you run a business, people also understand that it's not only one factor, it's the gut feeling, and it's a complex world. So you will need to make sense of it in a different way. So it's ordering. So a widely important goal is the most important aspect to start driving. For a base company, which I already used, for example, customer retention was one of the widely important goals they wanted to work on. So, and this is a clear indicator. If you discuss a widely important goal, what's the next thing to do? The next thing to do is to add some kind of metric. So we need some kind of metrics, data, which shows us if we either are approaching this widely important goal or going away from this widely important goal. So we need to understand if we do stuff, is it now helping us or not helping us? And this is, again, going more into the outcome, into the business domain of this thing. It's a trend metric. It's not a KPI. So metrics are always there to learn from, not to judge on. It's a learning mechanism. If we ask about widely important goals like retention, if we ask people and business people, and actually through less product owners, if we ask them about metrics, which kind of metric will show us that we approach this widely important goal, then most probably we get lag metrics. A lag metric means we can only start measuring after we have invested the complete thing. So after we put everything into production, and after we, yeah, basically we did the full investment and we cannot even steer away anymore. So we just spend $1 million, we put it into production, and we start measuring the trend metric. Yeah, okay, we already lost 1 million if it doesn't move the needle. So, but lag metrics are important to validate, especially if you have a high level of integration, then the lag metric could be sufficient. But in most large scale, we need something more because the lag is coming way too late. And if it becomes way too late, then people want to reassure, and then you get into risk management, too much details up front, and all the rest of the misery you most probably are familiar with. So what do? We discuss with people, and we try to figure out what are a couple of lead metrics. So what are leading metrics that could show us, that are giving us an idea, which we can evaluate at least every sprint, that gives us an idea if we are approaching this lag metric and this widely important goal. So this is also a trend metric. A lead means that we can still steer about it. Every sprint we can evaluate, did we now do something that moved the leading metric, yes or no? And we have an assumption, and this is important, we have an assumption towards a lagging metric. So this assumption is very important to make this very explicit, because we can spend a lot of money on the lead metrics and assume, yeah, this is going great. And if the lead metric is not moving the lag metric, then we also lost lots of money. So those are assumptions that are very critical to make them very explicit so that you can discuss about this with business while executing on delivering new features or expanding your product or even creating a new product. So in some cases, depending on the context we are at, you might even add a budget burn down. So meaning like, okay, it's a bit like Amazon. Amazon calls it bets. They really say, okay, we're going to place a bet, a couple of $100,000 or even $1 million. We can place a bet that this will be successful or useful for us. And then we have a burn down. If we start spending money, we just do a burn down. And this makes it easier for a less product owner or a less huge product owner to start weighing in, okay, what are we going to do and to order the backlog and also to run the business. We have some widely important goal. We understand the lag and the lead metrics. I also understand how much money we already burned to move the needles on the lead and the lag. And then we can decide as a product owner, as a business person, to add more money or to reduce the money or to even stop it. We spent already too much money. We don't see that much impact coming towards our widely important goal, so forget about it. So those are the things that are important. So widely important goals, I mentioned the retention of customers, but many organizations, of course, even if you deliver a feature and you only know about the feature, there must be a widely important goal behind it. So I'm wondering, like, what is your widely important goal? So what do you think is your widely important goal you're working for at this moment in time? So please type something in. There were people that work with outcome-based backlogs that are more used to the terminology, maybe. Others might need to think very deeply. If you don't know, you can just type in don't know as well. Maybe that's also good. I've been in many organizations, if you go to the ground floor and you ask about why the important goals, that they were like, ooh. It's a bad signal, but anyhow, it is what it is. 3 seconds to go. So, HEAL cable industry, I think that's a very nice one. So people that need don't know, okay, don't know is the majority of the people don't know what the widely important goal is. So, which is pretty frustrating. Most probably you don't know because you still have a separated business and an IT department. It's a dysfunction on its own. It should be one, but anyhow. So maybe it's because you still have too much of this Chinese whispering ongoing. So there's one talking to the customer that actually Chinese whispers it to somebody else and to somebody else, and then a business analyst and then a technical analyst. So there's too many in between. There are many, many different reasons that are structural in that sense. And also then outcome-based backlogs will not really be helpful. You need to change the structure for it. So, HEAL cable industry, I think is a very interesting one. New customers, of course, customer retention. Changing the world is a bit maybe too flu, but it's a nice goal. But let's discuss a bit more if we talk about really going into mind maps like that. So large conversion, maybe not. So this depends on context. But you get some ideas now. What is an okay, widely important goal? What is less of a good one? But this we expect from a product owner to actually put it into place in discussions. If there's a separate business department in discussion with the business department. So then we continue. If we know, understand what is the goal, what are the metrics that we understand that we move towards a goal or not, maybe adding some of the financial aspects to it. Then the next thing to do is to see, okay, who is actually capable of impacting this widely important goal, those metrics. So, and who means which customer segment, for example, maybe it's an internal department in your organization. Maybe it's a persona that you serve with your product, with your service. Maybe it's a single individual. We also do I also help with the less adoption at the Governmental Institute for Pensions in Belgium. So if the Minister of Pensions, which is a single individual, grants some law out, then this could have a huge impact on certain of the goals that they want to achieve. So the who is there as well, and then you can cohort in that sense. So this is the next thing to do. If we understand who actually is able to make sure that we impact those trends, it's never me as a development thing. Yeah? So me as a development team, most probably not, unless you deliver developer tools like I love ChatBrains, their tools, by the way. So if you deliver those tools, that's great. Otherwise, most probably not the right answer. Also, this you need to look from a more of a business perspective. If we understand who, then the next thing to ask is how. So, and how is really about behavior. So, which kind of behavior for this persona do we want to see more of, less of, introduced or removed completely so that we generate some kind of impact? This is also an assumption. So, now we have two assumptions that we made very explicit. And also there, without behavioral change, most probably you don't have much of an impact on your lack or leading metrics. If you deliver lots of stuff and there's zero behavioral change in your market or with your users, then forget about any of those trends moving along. So it's very important to make this very explicit so that you can validate and understand and discuss about this. And this is where the outcome kicks in, and that you're able to discuss those things. Only after we have identified the weeks, the trend metrics, so that we understand the outcome, the impact we deliver, and we understand who and what kind of behavior do we need to modify, change, or things. That's the moment when we start talking about the what. And that is what that we are building, this feature, this thing that we are building, that this will drive a behavioral change, is again an assumption. And I deliberately say as and then umption. So many of your organizations don't put the asses out. They keep it inside and it's hidden. So that's not a good thing. Why not? Because if you make them very explicit, then we can really apply things like the concept of minimal valuable product. You might rephrase it to minimal testable product. Comes from the lean startup. Most probably you're familiar with it. What is the core and the thing now, if we talk about MVP in this context, and if you use outcome-based backlogs, then we're really going to look for the absolute lowest cost possibilities to validate all three assumptions as fast as we can. Because if we validate all three assumptions as fast as we can, then we can actually build more of the what. As long as we didn't validate all three assumptions, we can build and we were risking losing lots of money. So we want to support business, we need to make those assumptions very explicit and then start validating them also very explicit so that we understand if the investment we do in the building is driving some of the metrics or the widely important goals within our organization. And that's an important aspect. If you look at the Lean Startup, Ash Murray come with this kind of nice thing from the Lean Startup machine. So this validation board is being very helpful. So even if you put this kind of mind map on the wall or in a tool or whatever you want, you can still use the validation board on the windows, on the walls, and then start to see, okay, you know, what are those assumptions that we need to validate? What is the core assumption? What are the most riskiest one? Then you can start having shared learning. Some of the assumptions will be validated, some will be invalidated. There will be wrong assumptions, don't worry. It's not because somebody puts it on paper that it's reality. They can have a very strong opinion and still be wrong in that sense. I've been in that position myself as well, and very strong opinions. And then I go into an organization, I have a very strong opinion, and I might turn in wrong. And that's why I always go back to myself as well. I don't really force my opinion when I mentor and coach. I keep it with them. And if it's something that I'm not 100% sure of, then I use this kind of sliders for the Agile Manifesto. If they implement this ID on the first values, will it move more to the left or the right side? And then I do it also for the second, the third, and the fourth value. And then if there's a slight tends to go more to the left, then it's like, really, well, let's try it out. I think it will fail, but let's try it out. Maybe I learned something myself. Also here as well, you will learn things. Important is that you have shared learning, that you share this kind of learning with the business, with developers, with UX people, with everybody. And that's an important aspect in this learning thing. So do you make your assumptions explicit in your organization? Do you know about those assumptions? Maybe you make them explicit, but you don't follow up on that. Maybe you make them explicit and do follow up on it. Maybe there's you don't even talk about it. Could also be. So, yeah, the majority is actually really talking about the assumptions behind the goals and how it will impact it, and they really evaluate them actively. Cool. So, please put in the chat, like, how do you validate, what kind of tooling? I shared now the validation board, but maybe there's other tools that you use to really make them very explicit and validate. So that's a cool thing to have. It's important if you want to discuss about business to make sure that you make those things explicit. Otherwise, you talk just about the implementation of a feature, and if it's used or not, that's not really sensible from a business perspective. Let's see, Blase, you lost your first position to the mad agilist. So that's cool. I love madness. So if you look at those things, the WICS, this lead and lag metrics, it's coming from the four disciplines of executions. Maybe you're familiar with it, maybe you're not familiar with it. If you Google on, if you search on YouTube, there's a nice like 7 or 8 minute introductional video to the four disciplines of execution, which give you a bit more insights in WICS, lag and lead metrics. If you want more inspiration, what would be a good, widely important goal, maybe metrics related to it, you can also search okrexamples.co. So okrexamples.co, it's for the OKR system, which I think is great. And the only thing I dislike is that they put it next to the backlog instead of in the backlog. If it's important, it should follow the same mechanism and a single priority, and not we have a product priority in the backlog and an OKR priority over there, then you don't have priorities anywhere anymore. So it should follow the same path. That's why in the OKR examples, you will find nice inspiration to define your WICS, your lead, your lag metrics. And so that's a cool thing. So the who, how, what is also something I stole from somewhere else, of course. This is more from my friend Hojko Adzik, so which made the impact mapping more popular. So I hope many people are, I hope you're familiar with impact mapping. That's the how, who, what. I had to learn from myself. The first mistakes I did with imp mapping is in the how, already talking about what and journeys, and then not really about behavior. So only working with Hoiko, I start to understand it's really about behavioral change. So and not nothing else. If you understand about this, there are other techniques you can apply. So things like from the UX world, so the user experience world, things from design thinking. So if you look at the who, and you think the assumption, the green assumption there, so between the WIC and the behavior, if you think we're taking a huge risk here in this assumption, we are really, really not sure, then I would recommend to use UX and design thinking practices to reduce the risk of making the wrong assumptions. It's reducing the risk, it's not validating that it's gone or not gone. You just reduce. The validation can only be done when the product is up and running. So all this kind of UX and design thinking practices are there to reduce the risk and making the wrong assumptions. So if you take high risk assumptions, then please use design thinking practices for this. On the how, the who, but also on the how, where you have customer journeys, you can also use use cases. So use this kind of practices to reduce risk on assumption, on the behavioral assumption, but also on the what. So risk reduction in that sense. On the what, I think the most popular tool these days is still story maps. In between behavior and story maps, you might use event storming as a technique, which is another thing that is very useful in that context. This is all depending on the context of the feature or the goal you want to approach. There's no one way for everything. So the one way is the WIC, the who, the how, the what, but like different techniques that you use in that sense depends on the risk you're taking, the kind type of product you have, the type of service, and all the rest of the things. So be creative in that sense. So let's have another quiz. Who is creating and maintaining this kind of mind map? Now we have a huge mind map with the WIC and then how and who's. Three seconds to go, 24 answers. There's still a couple of people that didn't answer. There we go. All together. Yes, of course. Now, then again, we say now all together, but if you look in real practice in an organization, where do you see the WICs being defined and the ordering of the WICs? Where are the trend metrics? This most probably in the red scenario there, the triangle corner, so the business. So it's not really together. They just do it by themselves and they throw over the solution. So, but the crucial part in really working with outcome-based backlogs is making sure that you do it all together. And thus, how does this all together work? A mad agilist, you're still in the running, but blasé, you need to be faster, I guess. And then you will catch up again. So the same for Jatin. So if we know in this thing and we do it all together. So we do this together in what is less called the product backlog refinement. So we have a product backlog refinement. We have 8 teams there, 7 people. So 56 people already from the teams. Of course, we have many end users, stakeholders, business people joining in. So most probably you end up with a little bit more than 100 people in the refinement session. So how are we going to work now? So the product owner comes with the WIC. So the last product owner will stand in there and say, okay, my widely important goal I want to work on is this one. And most probably he or she will also come with the lagging metric. So together with the people involved, we are going to brainstorm for possible leading metrics and then really prioritize or vote for it so that we have one or two leading priorities, leading metrics related to this WIC and the lagging metric. Maybe this widely important goal is too big, like changing the world. We had changing the world in our inquiry or the Kahoot before. So if the WIC would really want to change the world, that's too big. Now we need to split it up into more several WICs. So if it's retention in the customer, like customer retention, which we had with base company as well, we did some investigation. We really had to look at the age between 20 and 40. So we cohorted and we made another WIC and we said, okay, the retention in the customer segment of 20 to 40 years old. So then we get a smaller WIC, which is contributing to the bigger one. So which makes it more focused, more impactful to work on. And the high focus is important to drive your business. tackling everything at once will drive nothing. So that's why we might split it up into smaller weeks and cohort in that sense. Cohorting means like location, it could be age, could be sex, so many of those things. That's a very frequently used technique to actually split weeks into smaller pieces and have a higher focus level, which makes it easier to measure trend metrics and to evaluate impact at the end. So if we split it up into 2 weeks, this is a brainstorm session. Brainstorming is very easy. You always go with individual. So you first let individuals post put things on a post-it for a couple of minutes, and then you collect. If you collect and it's a bunch of people, like 100 people, then you disallow them to talk. Meaning you collect and you let them group, but in silent sorting mode. So people need to group silently, and you can move each other's post-its, and then you get clusters. So, and this is going pretty fast. With 100 people, really like having wicks, for example, clustered, we do this in about 10 to 15 minutes and that's done. The same with the who. The who, what are we going to do? We're going to select the wick we want to focus on first, and then we're going to say, okay, you get 3 minutes to brainstorm which customer segment, which persona, which thing, who can actually drive this widely important goal forward. So when people brainstorm, they do a silent sorting. Most probably you don't have four, like in the thing here, most probably you have 10, 20 of those who's, and that's okay. So now from that moment on, we are going to split the bigger group into smaller groups. Now we're going to ask to have people self-select into groups about maybe 7 to 9 people, something like that, with people from different teams, with different people from different profiles from the external world as well. And now we're going to ask this first team to select the who they think will drive the most impact. So nobody else is telling them, this who you need to work on now. This team decides, we think this who, this persona, this thing will drive the biggest impact on this widely important goal. So we're going to select this. They physically take the paper with them. So another team cannot select the same who. So another team need to select another who, which they think will drive the next biggest impact with the leftovers. And they're going to work on this one. It's not because we work on different who's that we need to deliver everything. It's not because we identify those are options that we need to deliver the options. So we're just generating lots of options without deciding which one to execute on yet. So the teams are most probably have, four or five who's that are going to be elaborated on, and then they continue. Within the team, the smaller team, they're going to discuss the behaviors they want to see more of, less of, or get rid of, or introduced for that persona, that customer segment, so that they will drive this impact. So they will discuss this kind of behaviors, put it in there. You give them, 15 minutes, 20 minutes, something like that. It's not that much time. So they discuss this, and then they take the behavior, they split them up again into 2 smaller teams, for example, or they keep the 1 big team, depends on context. And that's when they came up and they say, okay, what can we do? What can we deliver now? What can we change? What can we put onto a product, on a server, so that this behavior is going to change for that persona, so that the widely important goal is taking steps forward. So that's the what. And that's the moment when you get this kind of story mapping into place. What is now very fun in this kind of outcome-based backlogs, which is a mind map, it's not a flat list, it's really a mind map. What is the fun part now? If there is huge assumptions between the WIC and the behavior, for example, then we allow UX people already to work on lowering that assumption of making the wrong assumption. While they are working on this assumption using UX practices and customer interviews, they deliver the feedback, the learning they get immediately to the teams that are already working on the what. So, and this is a very crucial aspect. Now we have discovery and delivery happening within the same sprint, within the same team. So, and it's never going to be 100% on discovery doing UX practices. It's never going to be 100% doing the delivery practices. It's going to be a mix. And depending on the risk on the assumptions you take, it might be more of one or less of the other. So, and it's moving in time. And that's an important aspect to consider, so that we really validate those business assumptions along the way. So, Gene, you had something to say?
Okay, I just want to give you a heads up. 5 minutes before the hour, in case if you want to take any questions.
We're getting to the end, so, and I'm available after the hour for questions. Sorry for that. No. Anyhow, so one of the biggest mistakes I see that people go and say, okay, you know what, we are driving this behavior where the story maps is there, but you know, it's also the same behavior for another who. let's do it all together. And by putting it all together, you lose the connection between what you are doing and the assumptions you made explicit. So you don't know anymore if you're not driving business, yes or no. So please don't do this kind of thing there. Now, another thing, so multiple choice. Where do we validate assumptions made and make adjustments accordingly? As soon as possible, every quarter by business, when we make the yearly budget plan, or during review sessions. As soon as possible and during review sessions. If you are in the opportunity that you deliver multiple features in production, then most probably as soon as possible is in there, and depending on context as well, but at least, so as soon as possible, great, but at least every review session. Why in the review session? As soon as possible might be with a select group of people that work on this. In the review session, you get into shared learning so that everybody understands where the business is going, and that's an important aspect. So that's where this review definitely comes into place as well. So a couple of things to add to this. So in the review, that's a review session could look like this. That's a review bazaar. I will spare you the details. That comes later maybe. Now, but you could go beyond. So if you have this mind map on the wall, we did this now for a backlog, an outcome-based backlog. You can also get it into sprint plannings and use it as your sprint board. So you can have a refined state where you are more black, more gray, depending on the refinement state. It's either a bigger ball or a smaller ball, depending on the complexity you have to deal with. And if you then go into planning sessions, you can actually say, okay, you know what? We're going to add scenarios, positive scenarios, negative scenarios, whatever. So we add more details into our mind map. It's not only balls. You can also have wireframes on top of that and things like that. We add more details. So now we can also color it in, depending on the state. The green here means it's running in production. So we build it and it's running in production. With this, we can already validate assumptions going back into our mind map. So the orange one there, payment retrial, is, you know, we have done development, but it's not in production yet. So we can validate the first two assumptions between the what and the behavior and the goal, but we cannot validate the lead and the lag assumption yet. So that's an important aspect. The red ones we took into our current sprint planning and we're working on. And this way you get a very visible wall with all bubbles and extra information added, like metrics, wireframes, and all that stuff, all on the wall, which gives you a good sense of driving business. And you also understand if I deliver a feature, how is it impacting the business and the other way around? Because it's in one visual aspect in that sense. So if you want to get your business involved, broaden up your product definition as a prerequisite, have a high level of integration as a prerequisite, collaborative refinements. So where we do this kind of from a week and a lag metric, from that moment on, we include teams and everybody involved so that everybody understands the impact we want to drive. So the reviews, we need to talk about the assumptions that we made explicit. We don't review a feature. We need to review the assumptions. That's the business assumption. That's the risks we are taking in driving our business the wrong direction or the right direction, and continuously uncover better ways. You know, I shared now experiments I run with my customers. You might have others. It's just one way. It's not the way. And that's also important. It's not the way. It's just one way. So let's evaluate the first question we had. Are you using outcome-based backlogs? After now going through this kind of explanation, do you still think you're using outcome-based backlogs? Yes, no? Or did you change your ID? We had 6676 before. It's the last question, Gene. So don't worry, we're really at the end.
We're in the beginning.
So now we have 60. So at least people have an idea what that means. That's cool. And there's a lot more people that understand now as well, like, okay, we're not yet there. So please go for it. If you want sensible business interactions, then those are really, really useful tools. So my purpose really is to help organizations to build great products with great teams. So, and I try to do it good So if you don't, then most probably you're going to suffer instead. Now, anyhow, let's see who's the winner. The gift voucher for a 2-hour mentoring call and a 50% discount, if applicable. If not, we'll figure it out to give you, I don't know, some kind of voucher on Amazon or anything else. Let's see who's the winner. Blase, you are on third place. MW, second place. And on the first place, we have the Mad Agilist. So for the Mad Agilist, please send me an email. So
showing a screenshot of your phone that you're the Mad Agilist.
And then I will make sure you get your voucher and we get the arrangements done. Cool?
Okay. I do that then.
That's Shrikant.
Yeah.
Just email to Shrikant and just email to Jürgen.
I'll do that, Gene. No problem.
Okay, cool. So well, we have a date.
Sure, I'd love that.
Yeah, voila, that's your prize. So thanks for attending and thanks for sharing some of your thoughts. And I'm still available for questions for another half hour if you want. It's only in a half an hour that I need to go somewhere else. I understand that it was a 1-hour meeting, so that your time is up and that you need to leave. So that's also okay. Gene, anything else?
No, other than that, I really want to thank you for coming out, Jürgen. It's been a, you know, pleasure to see you always, you know. And now having shared your wisdom with the crowd here. So I'm happy, you know, to be able to accommodate you here, and you did a great speech. So thank you, everyone. Hopefully you had some something to take away, and please reach out to Jürgen directly if you have any questions. I will have this video recorded. I'm recording it as we speak, and this will become available within a couple of hours. Hopefully I will send it through the meetup. Everyone should be able to access it.
Cool.
I mean, Jürgen, if you want to, you have my host privilege. I'm sorry, I gave you host privilege, so you can stay. And if I have to drop another skip, you can still own the channel.
So everybody that has questions that want to discuss for another half hour, please go ahead.
Yep.
And otherwise, maybe we'll see each other later.
Otherwise, I'm gonna just ask you to come back again. You know, I love you doing Kahoots too. I mean, Kahoot is a great way to keep people awake. well, thank you all. And by the way, thank you all explicitly who joins on camera. This way we have more FaceTime and more real time, you know, real interaction. So thumbs up. Yeah?
Thank you very much. Cheers. Bye.
Stay here if you would like.
Thanks so much for putting it on. It was fantastic.
Yeah, my pleasure. Just sharing experiments. So.
All right. Actually, I'm going to draw up too.
You're on, Gene.
Jürgen, keep it running. Keep the heartbeat.
I will stay here until everybody's gone.
Don't say anything.
Or until I hear a question.
Don't say nothing bad about me behind my back, okay?
No, never do
so. Okay. Do you know Jen Divish?
Can you type it in the chat?
Yeah, J A N, last name, first word D E, second word V I.